All right, let's head north to just outside of Washington, D.C., and Mike Donnelly. Mike is the senior counsel for Homeschool Legal Defense Association of the United States, and he also serves as the chairman of the Advocacy Committee on the Global Home Education Exchange. Take it away, Mike.
Well, thank you, Peter, and everyone. It's great to be with you today, and boy, there is so much to talk about here, but I'm going to try to keep it brief, and I appreciate the words of Chris and Vinicius before me. We're talking about winning in the court of public opinion, but it's much more than public opinion. Advocating for homeschooling requires advocacy in many areas, and each audience is a little bit different. And you know, we're talking about legislators, but also media. We're talking about our neighbors, our friends. We're talking about the culture. And one thing I think at the outset we can realize is that homeschooling, home education, it's a global movement. You know, the world has become a much smaller place. We have people here from many different continents. I've had the pleasure as HSLDA's Senior Counsel and Director for Global Outreach to visit many of the places represented here and to get to know some of these individuals and many more. And the truth is we can help each other. We can learn from each other. You know, in the United States, we're blessed to have had decades of experience with a growing, flourishing movement and with lots of research. You know, many people may not realize this, but homeschooling was not legal in the United States in many countries, many states rather, in 1980. Only about five states explicitly recognized home education as an exemption from compulsory school attendance in 1980. It was 15 years before every state in the United States recognized homeschooling as a legal, explicit exemption from compulsory school attendance. And since then, going on 25 years or 30 years now, we have seen homeschooling grow dramatically in the United States from virtually nothing to about 2 million before the pandemic. And now the numbers suggest that homeschooling has doubled or perhaps even tripled or even more in the United States to as many as 8 million children being homeschooled, which is at least 10%, maybe 12 to 15% of the school age population. And that's something that it takes a while to lay the groundwork for that. But we can learn from each other. And I think we have a lot to offer and we're available to serve you, your community, and to help you with research, with ideas, with advice, with suggestions, with encouragement. If we can be of service to you, please, I hope you will get in contact with me. But I want to talk about some obstacles. When we talk about winning in the court of public opinion, advocating for homeschooling, we need to recognize that we are up against some obstacles, especially in countries where the homeschooling movement is small. Homeschooling is different. Those of us who are homeschooling, we know that it's, you know, we're doing something different. And most people don't do it. In the United States, 90% of the people don't do it. In other countries, it may be 99.9% of the people don't do it. And so they've never even heard of it. They've never considered it. My own story is, I'd never heard the word homeschooling put together until I had three children. And my neighbor asked me about, you know, what I was going to do for education with our children. My wife and I have been married for 8 years at the time. We had three children. And we had no idea. We knew we didn't want to enroll them in public school. We thought maybe a private school. And my friend said, well, have you ever considered homeschooling? And I'm like, I had no idea there was such a thing. It's different. And people hear about it in different ways. But even if you want to do it, you may encounter some different reactions from your friends, from your neighbors, from your family. And so we're talking about the culture. And people, you know, if they have heard about it, they have these stereotypes, these caricatures in their minds about what they imagine homeschooling is and what homeschoolers are like. And so when you say, oh, well, homeschooling, they get these ideas in their head. So we have to realize that we're up against these stereotypes also. And the fact that it's unknown to most people. Many people fear the unknown. They don't understand something, they fear it. You know, most people are not willing to take that path that's been less trodden, that's been less taken. And so they are in some ways maybe threatened personally by this idea of people doing something differently. So we need to know that there's a maybe an unspoken obstacle that we may be up against with our friends, neighbors, and family. And also, we need to recognize that homeschooling threatens the status quo. There are entrenched interests in a variety of areas in cultures and in your country, in your society, and that includes the big education industry. Education is one of the single largest budget items in any government expense. There are unions of teachers. There are unions of school boards. There are unions of school administrators, all dedicated to protecting their turf, their territory, their power, and their bureaucracy. And the way you protect bureaucracy is by, you know, controlling everything within it, making it bigger. That's just a fact of life. And so we've got to realize that, you know, home education threatens that status quo. And so there are interests that are arrayed against us. Now, it's interesting, in the United States, we were able to prevail, even though we were up against the most powerful entrenched interest groups existing. And, you know, many people would say that's miraculous. It's an evidence of God's protection of homeschooling. And I believe that's true. But I think there are some other things about the United States that make our country different that contributed to the growth of homeschooling. And that's not what we're going to talk about here. But these are three obstacles that if we are going to be advocating for homeschooling, and whether it's in the media, in legislatures, or in the culture, we need to know and identify those obstacles. And there are others, but these are just some ways of thinking about those obstacles. And as we are out there advocating for home education, we need to have a good message. We want to have a winning message. And it's going to be communicated in different words, in different ways, in different cultures, in different countries, in different languages. But ultimately, I believe there are three winning messages that you should consider. And if you have ideas for other winning messages, I want to hear them, because I'm sure there are others. But this is how I think about it. And this is based on 15 years of experience communicating the home education message in the media, in the culture, and in legislative bodies, both national, international, and at the state and provincial level. First of all, you know, people are concerned, you know, if an obstacle is they think homeschooling is weird and isolating, which we know it's not, the research says it isn't, but they think it is, we've got to have a message that home education is good for kids. It's good for children. Children are not going to be harmed by home education. And we can communicate the research. We can communicate the stories. And as Vinicio said, I completely agree. We'll talk about that in a few moments in the four P's and principles of how to advocate that I've come up with for you here. But the faces of homeschooling, the families of homeschooling, we've got to get the families out. We've got to get out there and communicate and show that that's true. So there is excellent academic and social outcomes in home education. That's the norm. That's average. Excellence is just average in homeschooling when compared to other populations. So that's a winning message, I think, and it's a critical one. Freedom. Freedom is a winning message. Who doesn't want to be free? Everyone wants to be free to pursue their own hopes, dreams, desires for themselves, for their families, and for their children. And that's a winning message. We found that freedom in itself is a winning message. So when we place home education in the context of a larger freedom message, that's a winning message. Second, home education is good for communities and it's good for countries. Home educators, the research shows, volunteer. They're active in civil society. And that's something that most democracies and participatory governments value to a degree. And that's different from politics. And then pluralism. Pluralism is respecting differences. It's not multiculturalism, although some people talk about it in the context of multiculturalism, but it's about pluralism. It's about realizing that within our countries, we can do things differently, and that when we do things differently and we create space and room for people to pursue their own personal vision for their families, for their communities, based on self-governing principles, that's good for communities. That's good for countries, generally speaking. Finally, the human rights aspect. We in the home education community can talk on solid ground when it comes to international law and human rights. Unfortunately, the United Nations and other institutional bodies and countries and movements who want to control education for their own purposes believe that they're on solid ground. And so they only talk about the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. But when you understand the totality of education rights and the international human rights law and aspects of, you know, the last, what has it been, 1950, 60, 70 years since the UN started with the Universal Declaration on Human Rights and the different treaties that come out of that, we are on very solid ground to argue that home education is a natural, fundamental, and inalienable right. When you look at education, you can look to UDHR 26.3, which defines education, but ultimately says that parents have a prior right to decide the kind of education that shall be given to their children. This is a very important principle, that the family unit is the fundamental group unit of society, Article 16.3. Parents are key in the context of education and in education rights, where the state must respect and protect the rights of parents to make these decisions. And when you look at the International Bill of Rights, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights, and the European Charter of Fundamental Rights and other, the African Covenants, the Inter-American Convention, you can find the support for, you know, the family as a primary body for education. And so, you know, to the extent that this is persuasive in your country, we are on very solid ground and we need not fear these, you know, treaties and human rights. We can use them to advance messages. And we should not forget, you know, our own cultural and constitutional frameworks. Most of those in free and democratic societies will also support this idea of education within the family, even though, as has happened in some countries like Brazil, like Germany, where in Brazil, the Supreme Court there, you know, found that homeschooling was okay, it wasn't unconstitutional, or that's helpful in some respects, it could have been better. But, you know, in Germany, you have a court there interpreting its constitution, which says that, you know, the family, you know, has priority to be backwards, you know, even though there are on the paper, the explicit recognition of these rights, sometimes the governing mechanisms may not recognize that. And so we have to be prepared then to advocate before and after court cases that may be harmful. So how do we do that? Well, I want to give you four principles to consider when we're engaging with public opinion. And when I talk about public opinion, we're talking about culture, we're talking about media, we're talking about politics. Because culture, when you think about it, culture is upstream from both media and politics. But they influence each other. But I think the culture is stronger. And when you think about what's upstream from culture, you've got families, you've got belief systems, you've got religion, those things. So those are important, but we can be present. We need to be present. If you're trying to make space, create space in your country for your movement, for the homeschooling movement, you have got to be present in all of these areas. You have to be present in the culture. You have to be present in media. You have to be present in politics. You know, if you show up, as they say, showing up is 90% of anything. You've just got to show up and be present and not give up. You know, some people can get discouraged. You know, they may be tempted to say, oh, this is too hard. Well, that's the test we have as home educators in countries where it's small. And that's the test we had in the United States. We had to be present. We had to show up and fight. And in 50 states, in many places, we had to do it. But if you do show up and you don't give up, you'll be victorious. You will prevail. If you give up, if you cede the battlefield, so to speak, then you will fail. We have to be persistent. We have to be persistent in showing up all the time. Whenever there's something happening that will allow us to get our winning messages out, we've got to be there. We've got to be there all the time. We've got to create relationships, as Chris said. I think that's absolutely essential. That's how you persuade people, which is the next point, being persuasive. So you know, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Said another way, people, you know, will be much more willing to listen to you after you have listened to them. And so we can't just be messengers who jump into every situation and just blast out our message, because it's not going to be received. We have to develop relationships with legislators, with cultural influencers, with members of the media, by listening to them, by helping them, by finding out what's important to them. And it's going to be different in each area. And then once we've developed that relationship face to face, we'll be much more persuasive. As Vinicius said, you know, bringing the families to the legislature, there is no substitute for bringing good looking, good families, families whose children are excellent representatives for homeschooling, to meet with their legislators. We need to put a face to the names of the families and the movement. And that's what it means to be practical. So being practical, we've got to think about ways that we can engage with these influencers, legislators, reporters. Means having a website. It means writing a lot. It means networking and making contacts with reporters and people who write about education. And, you know, for example, you know, if you can bring stories to the reporters, you know, they won't write about it every time. But if they know that when an issue presents itself, they can turn to you for a comment or a quote to help them on their story, that's good, because reporters, they're busy people, and you know, you can make it easy for them. We also, you know, in being persuasive and practical, we want to be positive, right? It's very easy to say, oh, the schools are terrible. People already know that, okay? Or they're not great, they're not doing good. People know that. We don't need to harp on that or focus on that. We have a positive message that's good for children. Homeschooling is good for children. It's good for countries. It's good for communities. And we can let the schools just sort of be there. Now, that doesn't mean you don't talk about them when asked, but the point is we have a positive message. And so we want to share that positive message. So it's a big job to change a culture. In some countries, there's a very hostile culture, such as Sweden or Germany or France. And, you know, it's not easy to change a culture. But if we want to make homeschooling freely available, that's what we've got to do. So I hope this has been helpful. Thank you, Peter. Let me turn it back over to you.